Good evening, church. God bless you. I want to say thank you for coming out tonight. This is our first Bible study that's been aired on Facebook, live streamed. I really don't know how to do a Bible study online like this. I know you might have questions along the way. I just want to tell you there's a 30-second delay or so between when I say something and when you hear it. That's, I guess, just the lag time of technology. But if you have a question, put it in the comment section and I'll do my best to find it and answer it as we go along. Just praise God that you're here. I'm glad to know that you want to learn the Word of God as much as I do. We've been living in a crazy time, haven't we? Who would have thought a month ago that the world would just turn upside down like it has? The Bible has many things to say about times like this. Usually when God's judgment falls on a nation or a people or on the world, God in the Bible, usually he'll use famine. That's one of the big ones that he uses to move things around. Sometimes he'll use natural disasters. The locusts will eat your field, or the ground will open up and swallow you, or there's something like that that's going to come about. Sometimes he uses armies of his opposing people to judge his nation. So the army invades Israel. You see that quite a few times in Scripture. But another thing he uses, and it's not very uncommon at all, is pestilence or the plague. He uses disease sometimes to get the attention of his people throughout the Old Testament. Now, I'm not here to tell you that God's judging the world through this coronavirus episode we're in right now, but I do know this. There are a lot of us that are thinking about life a little differently. Maybe that job doesn't mean as much as it did. Well, in fact, maybe that job is gone for many people right now. Maybe the future is very uncertain for several people. The idea of being able to continue to pay our bills and live in our houses, the idea that the stock market's crashing and whatever 401k we had is now a 201k and fast on the way to a 101k. I mean, this is a troubling time. It's a time for us to reflect and try to understand, God, what are you trying to tell us? I remember in 2 Chronicles, God says, if you'll repent, and if you'll turn back to me, if you'll pray, I'll heal your land. Perhaps our nation needs to heed that this evening. But as we go forward tonight, I want to talk about peace. Because I know there's a lot of people out there that are really upset about how things are going. And, you know, if you don't have Jesus in your life, if you don't know God for yourself, it's easy to turn to things like that bottle of alcohol or those drugs or some sort of other indulgence to try to find peace. And if you can't find peace, maybe at least you can numb the pain of what you're going through. God really doesn't want us to cope like that. He has a different mechanism for us. And that's the kind of thing I want to talk about tonight. So as we go along, if you have questions, please let me know. Write them down. If I get to them, if I can find them in all these computer screens, I'll do my best to answer them. But let's get started tonight. Look at the first slide. It comes out of John 16:33. Now, this is at the end of the discourse Jesus has with his disciples from John 13 to John 14 to John 15 and now John 16. This is the last verse of John 16. Jesus is summing it up. And what you need to hear while we talk about this is that these disciples have been truly rattled. Their peace is gone. Why? Because the one they've served, the one they've followed for so long, is telling them he's going to leave. Not just leave, but that he's going to be crucified, handed over to his enemies, and tortured and killed. And that worries them in two ways, I'm sure. Like, where are we going to go? What are we going to do? What's going to happen to us? And the other thing is, if they hate you enough to do that to you, if they associate us with you, Jesus, what are they going to do to us? So As we face our uncertain times here in March of 2020, we can think back to these guys. Their security has been lost as well. By the time you get to John 16, they're worried about their future as well. Let's see what Jesus says to them. He says first in John 16, 33, I have said these things to you. That's kind of the summary statement of, I've talked to you all the way back to John 13. I've been talking to you for the last several hours about these things. What has he said? He told them all that stuff because it says that in me you may have peace. Now, that's comforting all by itself, isn't it, church? To look at that and say, Jesus, the peace I need is in you. In fact, Jesus sort of spells it out for them at the end of this verse. In the world, you will have tribulation. Now, that's a promise you don't find in all the promise books you buy at the bookstore about how God loves us and wants to take care of us, but it's a promise nonetheless. Jesus says, you're going to have trouble. So we can't really look at today's events and the events of the last few weeks as surprising. Jesus said, there's trouble everywhere in the world. Why is there so much trouble? Well, this world is being run by the prince of the air, by the devil. It's being run by the enemies of God. And that sin, that hatred, that disobedience to God brings nothing but trouble. You and I, we escape the trouble in the sense that we can have the peace that God promises us. Well, we can't escape the trouble. A lot of times the trouble is right in front of us. Well, all right. Jesus adds this note of comfort as he ends this verse. He says, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Our comfort is here, that no matter what kind of trouble comes, we can find peace in Jesus. And not just peace in Jesus, but we can find the fact of faith, the fact that we know in our hearts, even if it doesn't look like it, Jesus has overcome the world. There is nothing more powerful, no force greater than Jesus himself. He created the earth. He sustains the earth. He created all that is. And he has said, I have overcome the world. That's a point for you and me to take a hold of and relax in. But when he says to them, I've said these things to you, I want to go back and look, Jesus, just exactly what did you say? I'll take you all the way back close to the beginning to John 14. He says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Now, again, what a fantastic truth. Jesus promises his disciples peace and even qualifies it. I'm going to give you peace not as the world gives. Do I give to you? Think about that. I mean, do you have peace in your life with all this stuff going on? There's really only one source where we can have peace, and that's the peace that Jesus gives to all who follow him. I just find that so phenomenal that Jesus is saying to them at the beginning of this discourse from John 13 through 17, he's saying to them, look, I'm going to give you my peace. So I know you're rattled. I know you're shook up. I know you feel like the sky is falling and the earth is about to collapse and it's almost all over, but I'm going to give you my peace. And it's not going to be any regular kind of peace. It's not going to be something that anybody else really understands. It's going to be peace from God. Wow. Thank you, Jesus. But I want you to see the bottom of that verse, that slide. You see at the end of 27? This is a command from Jesus. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Neither let them be afraid. One of the greatest killers to peace is fear. That's obvious, isn't it? When you start playing that what if game, what if this, what if that happens, what am I going to do when blah blah, when in fact none of those things have actually happened, when in fact you don't know what's going to happen for sure. In the end, sometimes one of the devil's greatest strategies is to get our hearts and our minds set on the circumstances of our problems instead of set on God, the one who holds us in his hand, the one who knows about the number of hairs on our head and cares for us like like he knows when a sparrow falls. He is intimately involved in all aspects of life. Jesus says to these guys at the front end, don't fear. Fight fear. So you and I need to take this to heart. If we find ourselves winding up, if we find ourselves playing that what-if game and thinking about all the disaster that could come our way, we need to really take hold of our minds and say, Lord, forgive me for worrying about things that haven't happened. Help me rest in you. Help me not be troubled. Help me understand that this fear is crippling, does me no good, gets me nowhere. Very important, very important. So Jesus says he's going to give them peace. I think we should go back a little farther, because at the beginning of John 14, here he comes again. Let not your hearts be troubled. One of the things Jesus addresses with these disciples who are panicking, and I guess that makes it appropriate for us to address it in case we feel like panicking with all this coronavirus news going around and all these people dying and all this suffering going on. Jesus says, don't worry. Now, it's easy to say don't worry, right? What do you do not to worry? Well, here it is. Believe in God. How simple is that? Believe also in me. In other words, exercise your faith. Exercise your faith. Instead of getting swallowed up by fear and looking at your circumstances, believe in me. Believe in God. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't be afraid. Very important news for us, because our temptation is to wind up and get all excited about the bad things that are going on and play the what-if game until we've wrapped ourselves into an anxiety that we can't untangle. Jesus says, look, you're my followers. I love you. I am going to care for you whether I'm physically here or not. That's what he's meaning with these guys in John 14. He's about to go to the cross. They don't know what's going to happen to them. And the reassurance Jesus gives them is, don't get worried, because I care about you. I care about you. What you have to do is believe. You have to start looking at what God says is true and not looking at what the world is telling you. It's harder for us in these days because we have these news feeds that are bombarding us 24/7 with everybody's opinion, every little minute detail of who said what, who scratched their nose at the meeting. I mean, you can just hear all kinds of detail that, you know, formerly in ancient times, nobody would ever really focus on any of it. And now it gets all blown out into some sort of event when somebody says something to someone else and the political leaders don't shake hands the right way or whatever. Jesus says, look, your remedy is here. You're going to find your peace in me. That's where it is. It's not a peace like the world gives, but you got to guard yourself against fear. You got to guard yourself against it. And while you're guarding yourself against it, believe. Exercise your faith. Make sure you look to me. That's his lesson. Now, we're going to keep going for a little bit in this beginning of John 14 because there's more here for us. He says, in my father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? I want you to see this. Jesus is not just talking about here and now. He starts talking about future. In my Father's house are many rooms. In other words, God has room for you if you're in Christ. He knows you're coming. It's going to be prepared. He hasn't told us about it because he wants to lie to us. He told us about it because it's the truth. And he says, if I go, that means if I go to the cross and die and rise again, and if I leave this world for the next, if I go and prepare a place for you. In other words, when I get to my kingdom and the throne room of God, I will be preparing something just for you. Just for you. I will come again and I will take you to myself. Here's one of the most beautiful lines in all the New Testament, that where I am, you also may be. I think that's so phenomenal to think that God's quest in his life is for us to be with him, that we might be forgiven for our sins and clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, to be with him. Do you get how intimate that is? Do you get how that would just drain the worry out of your heart and mind if you really grabbed hold of the fact that the God you serve wants you to exercise your faith and believe and understand that when he makes this promise that he has a place prepared for you, that he wants to be with us, that he's dying for us so that our sins can be forgiven, so that we can spend eternity with him? I mean, I can tell you, if you really take these truths to heart, you're going to have a phenomenal attitude no matter what your circumstances are, because the truth that Jesus speaks is never going to change. You know, CNN or the news people, their truth might change. The fake news, the president, who knows who's going to say what, trying to calm the fears of all of us as we face these difficulties. Jesus never lies. He can't lie. When he tells you that if you're in Christ, he's going to take care of you, not only now with a peace that passes all understanding, but later with a place where you're going to spend eternity with him, because he wants to be with you. He wants to be with me. For all who have confessed him, he wants his family to be gathered to himself. Man, that's a truth that ought to carry us through whatever difficulty we face. What a beautiful thing God has done for us with that truth. Let's look at the next verse. He says, you know the way to where I am going. And Thomas, of course, says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Again, I think it's so appropriate that this question is inserted into this statement Jesus is making. Why? Because we see that the people that follow Jesus in the New Testament are not perfect people. They're trying to rationalize and think through the things that Jesus is teaching them, and they don't have an eternal perspective. They struggle in many of the same ways that we do. We have trouble seeing what's coming. Instead, we look at where we are and we see what's bad about it. Thomas is going, look, Jesus, don't tell me you know that I know where you're going, because I don't know where you're going. How can I know where you're going? And here comes the profound answer that Jesus gives him. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, a lot of the theologians in the world are going to park on the end of this verse and talk about how exclusive it is to enter the kingdom of God, that it only happens through Jesus Christ. And that's absolutely true. But what I want you and I to focus on tonight is Jesus' statement, I am. That's the ego me. That's the identification with the same name of God that was used in Exodus 3 when Moses saw the burning bush. Jesus is telling them again that he's God. I am the way. Now think about that, the way. You know, you might feel lost today. How are you getting through life? Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. You know, the rest of the world, everybody lies. Jesus says, no, I'm the truth. And the rest of the world, you know, we worry about our lives here, right? We don't want to catch the coronavirus. We don't want to get sick. We don't want to suffer. We sure don't want to die, although that's the only way to get out of here, right? In the end, Jesus says, look, I'm the life. I'm the life-giving force that's driven all the life that exists. I'm the life. You're in me. You don't have to worry. You just have to keep your perspective. You just have to believe, because nobody can snatch you out of my hand. So as we face this coronavirus, as we face these troubles in our time, I just want you to sit back for a minute and have some time of meditation. Let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart. Pray. Read these verses again for yourself. Watch this video again. Be sure you stop. Just park. Park your little head while you're thinking all the time and meditate. Meditate on what God has said. Because what God has said is true. And we know that regardless of how bad the coronavirus gets, how many of us get sick, how many of us die, this is the very fact that we have to be in this situation now where you're attending Bible study on a screen and I'm sitting in front of a camera and a microphone to try to make it happen. It's not much dialogue involved in this, is there? I just understand that God has a plan for this. There's a purpose. Who knows? Maybe this nation is going to submit itself to God again. Maybe we're going to turn. Right now, it's sort of ironic, isn't it, that people are starting to think about God again, thinking about the fact that they're mortal again, but now they can't come to church because we can't gather, at least not for the foreseeable future. That doesn't stop the Holy Spirit. That doesn't stop God's power. When people come to Him by faith, even if you're the only one in your room, when you get on your knees and ask Him into your life, you don't need to be in a building called a church. In fact, the other thing I think God is doing here is He's taking what we've thought about the church and sort of blowing it up. Because we've always thought about the church as a building with pews and a pulpit. When reality is that the church has been you and me in our relationship with Christ and our obedience to Him. That's the church. It's those who follow Jesus and who love Him and obey Him. And so now, our job is really going to be exciting. I don't know how God's going to use us, but when we come into contact with those who have fear, when we meet people that don't understand and are scared to death because they don't know what's going to happen to them when they die, we can tell them about the peace of God. We can tell them about the life that God offers. It's a beautiful thing. Now, I just want to take a minute here and before I go, address you all. I see Peggy and Charisse and Cynthia and Stacius Rose and Zinnia. I want to say welcome to all of you. I'm so happy you're here tonight. I just trust that God will send this out through you to many more people and that we'll all kind of be able to take God's chill pill. His peace is found in Jesus. In fact, let's just review this quickly. How do you find true peace? Well, what did He say? In me you will have peace. Right? That's where we started, 16:33 in John's Gospel. It happens in me. So one of the questions you and I can immediately ask ourselves is, am I in Christ? Am I in Christ? Have I confessed my sin to Him? Have I asked Him into my life? Do I belong to Him? Oh, it's easy to do if your answer to those questions is no. You simply bow your heart before Him and invite Him in. It's just a simple prayer. Ask Him to forgive you of your sin. Ask Him to come into your life. He'll establish a living, vibrant relationship with you if you don't know Him. If you do know Him, just understand that the peace you're looking for is not going to be found in alcohol. It's not going to be found in your job security. It's not going to be found in calling your friends to tell them how bad your day was. The peace we have is found in Christ. That's where it is. Remember, He told us, I have overcome the world. Yeah, we're supposed to have trouble. He promised us that, but He has overcome it. He says He's going to give us His peace. It's not like the world. This isn't just sort of a tranquilizer that makes us numb so that we can try to endure. No, the peace God gives is a peace that keeps us from worry, keeps us from fear, keeps us in the joy of the Lord and the peace of the Lord. It helps us understand that everything's under control, even if it looks like everything's falling apart. We focus on Him. What did He tell us? Believe. Put your faith in me. Listen to what I've said and know that it's true. Listen to what I, or look at what I've done and know that there is no other force in the universe that can do this. There's no one in creation like me. Jesus tells us that you can live in my peace, perfect peace, if you're in me. Don't let your heart be troubled. That's a essential component. We have to fight fear. We have to stop ourselves when we start playing what-if games and trying to look at ourselves like we're heading for disaster. Jesus says, look, even in the future, I'm going to live in your heart till you die through my Holy Spirit. But once you're soul has left this earthly body and you come into my presence for eternity, look, I have something prepared for you. I have a place. Do you think that's true? Is that true? I think it's true. Jesus says, look, you want to combat the fear of life and get through it? Focus on that. Meditate on that. Put that in your mind and let it swim around for a few hours. Don't let it go. Understand, Jesus has a place and he's coming back. Man, what a promise. I will come again to take you to myself. Is there any better solution to worry than that? Whatever we have to endure in this world, whether we die of coronavirus or we're martyred and crucified upside down like Peter was, or we die of old age in our bed, or we get hit by the bus while we walk to the park. However we go, Jesus says, look, I'm coming again. And my goal is to bring you to myself. My goal is to bring you to be with me. That's why he died for us. Man, I hope you're grabbing this. It's touching my heart just to tell you. And Jesus says it again in 14:6. He says, I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. You don't have to worry. You can have my peace, the peace that passes all understanding, because I'll bring you to myself. Jesus died to make this possible for us. He died to tell us that he loved us. He took the punishment for our sins so that you and I, through faith in Christ, can be forgiven and clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Now, I know still there's a lot of people that want to pray and want to have some support in that way. So I just want to remind you one more time of our website, ipray.world. If you just click on that link that says, please pray for me, you can enter your request. We'll be happy to pray as a team for whatever need you want to bring to our attention. No problem. That's all I have. I'm looking at this screen in front of me. I don't see any questions, so I think I'm going to go. I want to say thank God that Cynthia's testing was negative. We praise God for that. And thank God for Stacia's Rose feeling a little better. I trust, Rose, you're recovering. I praise God for all of you. I thank you for the support you give me. But I want you to just hold on to the fact that God's support is all we need. I want to pray for us before we go. Do you mind? Let me pray. Let's pray. Jesus, my heart is touched again by these truths, moved by the fact that you love us like this. What a phenomenal way to have a Bible study and end this day, to just focus ourselves again on the promises you've made and the person that you are. We offer ourselves to you afresh and anew. Lord, we ask you to forgive us for worrying about things. Instead, help us believe. Help us have faith. Help us know that you are true. When all else fails, you are still true, and we can depend on you. Help us support each other. Lord, we pray that you bring us to health if we're sick, or keep us healthy if we're already feeling well. God, I don't know what you're going to do with this church at Living Hope or your church in this country or around the world, but we offer ourselves to you as living sacrifices to serve you in whatever you call us to do. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God, church. Praise God. I know that he has a plan for us, and I know we're a part of it. So I just trust that you will work and praise and follow. That's the way. Until we meet again in the morning, seems like I do this about every 12 hours now. I trust you have a good night. And that you turn off that phone and turn off that TV and just let yourself meditate on the truths of these verses that we've studied tonight. God bless you. And until we meet again, may you serve him well.